Good morning, Aditi. Everybody is talking about yoga these days, particularly because of the yoga day approaching. That just reminds me of an anecdote. Once we had announced a course on teaching yoga, and a boy came to me and he asked the timings of the classes. I told him 10 to 12, 30 in the morning. So he said, "I can't do yoga for 2.5 hours. I told him, "Well, we'll teach you how to do yoga for 24 hours. I mean, Sri Aurobindo said, you know, all life is yoga. That's what he meant, that you can bring yoga into all your life. All life is suitable as a field for the practice of yoga. So you have been into Sri Aurobindo's yoga for a long time. So would you like to throw a little light on this very common misconception that yoga is just physical practices, and that's what this boy perhaps thought, and I gave him this reply which he might have never expected.
Yes. See, it's also most of our understanding comes from what we hear around us, what we read, and what is presented to us as a general form of information. And that is the reason our basic understanding when we hear the word yoga is more of physical practices, because that is what we see around in the publicity or the normal everyday conversations. But anybody who has dwelled a little deeper into it, they realize that it is more than that. Even now, when people who have got into physical practices, so it's like one, you're just talking about the physical practices, you know, yoga is physical practices. But even when you start doing physical practices, you yourself realize that this is more than physical practices, because you start seeing the effect of, say, the physical practice, which is essentially the asanas. So even if you're doing them in a particular manner, you realize that it is not just that it is helping you, say, stay healthy, but it is impacting you deeper. But to realize that, you just have to be a little quiet and see what is happening inside. So yoga essentially takes you inside. So physical practices is just one method to take you inside. And once you get that glimpse, you realize that it's a whole new world. And when you said, like Shabindu has spoken about, all life is yoga, because essentially it makes you aware about what is happening in, say, the psychological framework which is inside of you. And physical practice just gives you a little window to it, and then you realize, oh, the practices is also impacting my mind. Oh, there is so much in my mind which needs attention. So you may go from practices to the mind, then see how mind and practices are related, and then that opens a lot more deeper inside of you. And then you realize more and more that, oh, my actions also impact how I feel. Oh, how I feel also impact my state of being. So then you start seeing that how I'm experiencing the world is not just outside. It is an interaction between inside and outside. So though you start from the outside, you start realizing that there's an inner psychological makeup also, which impacts my outside. So just being associated with the idea of yoga and then into experience, it starts opening small, small windows about the interaction between the inner and the outside. And then it is an individual call, how deep do you want to take that interaction? Because the deeper you go in the interaction, it's many folds. It just opens one layer by another layer. And if you start enjoying that, say, the joy of discovery, you go closer and closer to, say, the absolute or the divine, which is in itself a journey. So yoga is more of a process than, say, just an experience in itself. So that process begins, and then it's an individual journey of what yoga means to the person. So that is how I see it around me. Yeah.
You have often been talking about moving from experience to expression. So once the experience has come from going deeper, maybe through the physical route, maybe through other routes, because again, Sri Aurobindo's approach is extremely comprehensive, and physical is only one of the approaches by which one can go within and deeper. So then how does this experience and this joy of discovery translate into outer life, into everyday life? Starts from the outside in case of physical practices, then goes within, and then from within, once again, it starts expressing outside.
See, it's also very basic, no? What you like, you want to do it again. It's a very human tendency. So if I say very basic, if I eat something, I like it, I want to eat it more. If I visit somewhere, I like it, I was like, next time also I'll come. I go or not, that's a different issue. But human nature is that if it likes something, it wants to repeat. But if you, so this is a mechanism, it is an experience. But when you take this experience deeper, it doesn't become repetitive. It goes more and more into depth. Because once you have that idea that, okay, now I enjoy looking at world from this lens. So it's like there's a lens which yoga has given me. And through that lens, when I look at the world looks different. So it is not that narrow conception of I, me, myself. It broadens my horizon. Oh, I can also look at other people. I can also look at life. So it's slowly that expression widens. And we know in our experience that when we go like this, the experience we feel is that, oh, I am the one who's suffering. I am the one who has all the issues. I am the one who's been cornered or I have not been heard in the world. But the more I open myself, I see it more inclusive of what is happening. So my interactions improve. And it's like the more I understand where my thoughts are coming from or my actions are coming from, I also develop an ability to see others. So if tomorrow somebody comes and say shouts at me, I will not immediately react as like, oh, he's shouting on me. Oh, so I don't have to protect myself. I'll see, okay, he must be in a bad state or there must be something wrong or the place he's coming from. It's fine. So yoga helps you become more rooted in your own self. So you're not always in that ready to fight mode that if somebody comes and I was like, no, because I have to preserve myself. Because there's also a very misconception in the world, no, that stand for yourself, be there for yourself, which in its essentially root is true. But that doesn't mean that you have to just always be in a preservation mode, which means that have a stability inside, be rooted, don't be dependent on the notion of self or others, not let others define you. So the more you have that notion of who you are insecured in that sense of stability, you are not looking for, okay, you tell me what do you think about me, you tell me what do you think about me, you know, you have a sense which is in progress. So it's not that now I know it, now I'm facing the world. So one thing which is very important to associate with yoga is that it is a process. It is unfolding day by day, and we have to align more and more with the time around us to go through it. So it's not that, oh, today I did yoga, like even forget for a minute the inner practices. Even the asanas, if you go to a teacher, the teacher will tell you that you will see the effects slowly. Because anything which is taking you to the roots will take its own sweet time. You take anything in the space. You take medicine in the space of inner world. You take ideas, you take asanas, because it is making room for a grounding. Like it's a massive construction, but an inner construction. So the grounding needs to be well established. So it's a space which gives us a lot of joy because we understand better, because we expand, we step out of our narrowness and start experiencing the wideness. And there's a different kind of joy in looking at life from a deeper perspective or a higher perspective. For example, now I'll just give that one example maybe. Like how when we go higher and higher, you know, people, why do people like to go to mountains? It is not just the weather, because the view from there, you can see everything. You feel that, yes, it's a possibility. So the higher you go in your consciousness also, the wider you see, and that is the joy which we like. And that is like the aim which helps us grow deeper. So that is how I see the process of unfolding of yoga as a process.
Well, I mean, we, those who have been in the field of yoga, tend to look at yoga as a spiritual discipline and link it to the deeper truths of existence, which we find in spirituality. But in a somewhat simpler form, you find that these are things that are being talked about by lots of people these days, somehow in the air. Well, whether we call it yoga or spirituality or call it by other names such as positive thinking and so on, do you think it really matters? Because the type of changes that it will bring about in the way we might behave would still be quite similar.
I think this depends entirely on what are you seeking? So, like, how in our outside world, or say, for example, academic world, so there are different levels, no? There are different classes. So everything which is taught in a class has its meaning. So I can't say that what is taught in the second grade is not worthwhile because I'm looking at it from the fourth grade. So everything, it's like I have come to you for an immediate solution, that this is my problem, I want solution. You give me that solution, it works for me. At that moment, I can't tell you that, oh, there's a deeper truth, let the divine help you. Yes, that's a broader area on which I will base my interaction with you. But maybe you right now need an immediate requirement which needs a solution. So you might not be looking for a deeper quest. So today, the good thing is that everything is available. It's like, depending on what you are seeking, you have the choice to go to it. So if I'm seeking an entry-level understanding, which is serving me well, that is my journey. But if I'm looking for something deeper, then that is also available. I go deeper. But the essential thing is that I'm very much aware of what my purpose is. And there's also a possibility I enter and then I realize that, oh, I was looking for much deeper. Even I didn't know. So there's all kinds of possibilities. That is why I say, you know, it's a joyful discovery that you enter through. For there's a lot of people who enter yoga through asanas because, oh, they thought that this is good for my body. And then when they start reading literature or the kind of teacher they go to, they realize, oh, it's such a deeper field. It is not just my... So it depends on what is your entry, what is your intention, and how far are you willing to go. So depends on your a combination of your intention and your will, and also the person. So it works both ways. So one who is entering and one who the person is going to. So the person whom I'm going to, what is that person's journey? What is that person's intention? So it's always an interaction. And in that interaction, the sincerity of that interaction, the willingness, the process of that determines, because even while talking, you grow, even by learning, you grow. So it's a growth of both the person who's coming together to interact more and more and grow deeper. So, and always have that sense of movement. I think yoga is not just union, it is also a sense of movement which takes you from point A to point B. Maybe my point A and B may differ from yours at the moment, but as long as I'm moving, I'm going somewhere. And if I'm going in the right direction, I will reach. It's a matter of time. So I just have to keep my will in place, is how I see it. What about you? How you think? Like, what are your views on that?
Well, as you were talking, I mean, there were a few things that crossed my mind. Sri Aurobindo has looked at these things from the deepest possible perspective, and also looked at it from the point of view of not just the yoga for the individual, but it's having a ripple effect and leading to a collective growth, collective change in the consciousness, a change in the world, which will come from change in human nature. All these things essentially come out to the same thing. And now we find that in the social media, there is a lot of talk which is again trying to take us from concern for the individual self to the wider issues such as environment. And there are people who are talking it at a fairly deep level, people like David Hawkins, Gary Zukav, Nikhidi Kartre. They have talked about it. The fact that they have talked about this futuristic vision without reading Sri Aurobindo makes it even more significant, which means that in a way, sort of this evolutionary thrust which Sri Aurobindo had visualized is actually finding more and more expression in more and more individuals who are going deeper into the roots of existence, are looking more within. But then we find that a lot is also being talked about in much simpler terms. Now, would you look upon it as something which is simplifying Sri Aurobindo or diluting Sri Aurobindo, or doesn't really matter so long as the vision that is being expressed is the same and the world is moving in the right direction? Naturally, going deep is not necessarily for everybody, and everybody doesn't have to. And the world has always lived these truths without necessarily going deeper into philosophy, and that's not always considered very essential either. In fact, knowledge at the mental level can also become an obstruction on the path of spirituality. So how would you look at this surge of this type of talk in the social media?
I think, again, it depends on the intention. I always come back to the intention that what in me is wanting to express or what in me is wanting to know. So if as a person who's talking about yoga, what is my intention? Why I want to express? And if my, and of course, intention is also not that like black and white. No, I genuinely want to do good. I want the world to change, but I also want the world to change through me. So that is also a possibility. So that is the through me part is a part of my journey, but what is coming out of me is doing good to the world. So that also has its merit. That also has its value. And secondly, it also depends on, for example, even Shobindu has spoken about it, no? That everything can be seen, like, in fact, Mother has spoken, no? Truth is known when all is seen. But maybe at this stage, I am just walking towards the place where all can be seen. But where I am right now, there is also an element of truth. There is also an element of sincerity. There's also an element of wanting to know. So at every step, am I doing the best? So my first step is, of course, not my last step. So if I'm taking, say, like hypothetically, I'm taking 10 steps. So every step, am I able to go to the truth of that step? So I may not be able to go to the absolute truth right now, but even if I'm at the second step, am I connected to the truth of the second step? So that is enough for my journey at this point of time. So respect, again, I'm saying, no, the respecting the process and your progress is very, very important. And sometimes because of the kind of information available around, that gets difficult, that we have a sense of urgency even in the space of yoga. That now that I know, so I will watch like 10 videos together or I will follow 10,000 people and I was like, oh, this is one method, this is another method. And then I will have that urgency to also express, see, I'm also changing. So those are things which kind of a surface nature needs that cleaning. That is why we say, you know, that that discernment is important, that when to interact and when to step back. So all these things which are given to us have a purpose. But does that purpose align with my progress at the moment? So my purpose might be, okay, finally to find the divine. I also want to find the divine, but there are certain steps in between. So I can't jump those steps. So with a true intention and sincerity, if I'm going step by step, and every step, I have a sense of respect for my progress and for the progress of the world. So I'm not in that sense of comparison with my past self or with my future self or with the world around. But I'm really content in my seeking. That comes from a very deeper level. If I get into the competition in my seeking with the world, then that's an error. And that often happens because of the kind of information we are flooded with from the surroundings. So to maintain that discernment between the two, that is like essentially which determines my journey. And then see, everything which is outside can help me go inside if I have that discernment. But if I don't have that discernment and I'm very, very dependent on the outside and I'm blindly following somebody, then that discernment loses. Then that sense of urgency comes in to first experience. And then I also want to tell the world that I'm experiencing, I am changing. So there's also some sort of fixation with the tangibility of experience. But essentially, all of us who have experienced yoga at a deeper level, we know that it's the intangible space which is more widening, which is more encompassing, which is more inclusive. And it takes its own sweet time to build that bridge between the tangible and the intangible. And that bridge, nobody else can build it for you. No teacher, no surrounding. That bridge you have to build for yourself. And that is what is actual self-work in the field of yoga. So you do all the outside practices of yoga, you, the teacher, what teaches you, the videos you watch or the literature you read. All of those things are like really standing on the that side of the bridge, which can equip you well. But the construction of the bridge is an individual journey. And that is the actual journey of yoga. So when that bridge can be built between the inner and the outer, that is when your real journey starts. And once that starts, once that you have a glimpse of, then the kind of whiteness you were talking about in the beginning, then that is like the joy and you know it's like the game of eternity. So you drop that sense of urgency, you drop that sense of how do I look to the world or what is my contribution to the world? Because you know by nature, working on yourself, you're contributing to the world. So yeah, that is the space where Like if you ask me, the real yoga begins and then it's a journey of eternity. So yeah, that is how I see all of these things coming together.
Probably the best I can do is to just now summarize some of the points that you have made. So long as the intention and the direction is correct, we don't have to be obsessed with the destination. So the main thing is the sincerity of intention and moving in the right direction. However, there are some precautions or pitfalls, precautions to be taken because there are pitfalls. And one of the pitfalls is that even when we start with the best of intentions, we start with the feeling that I'm just one drop in an ocean, and that is sort of a very common simile used for that wider picture. I'm just one drop in an ocean. The ego has a way of entering through the back door. And then one starts feeling that I'm a bigger drop, a better drop. And that's how once again, the dilution begins. And that is one of the pitfalls which one has to guard against. As the mother has said, you know, that even in the impersonal work, gradually we start treating ourselves at the center of the universe, as if we are at the center. What we forget is that once we have decided to be a drop in the ocean or a cog in a cog wheel, the wheel can move smoothly only if all the cogs are the same. If one of the cogs grows oversized, then the wheel can't function smoothly. So that is what is important. So keeping these pitfalls in mind, basically what matters is the sincerity of the intention and the direction. Any closing remarks that you want to make?
So, I mean, it is such a vast topic, no, that we can keep talking about. And once, like you say, one word and something clicks and I was like, this can also be done. But essentially, to bring it to the very like practical daily basis, I also wanted to make one point that often if we want to do something new, there's a tendency of the mind to immediately make it its own. So like even if somebody wants to know, like now there may be new people every year who hear the word yoga around the yoga day and they want to explore that. Okay, I want to see what is it. So there, it's very important, like at the beginning only, if we give them a little more understanding. Like if somebody comes to you and tells you that, okay, I want to learn meditation, teach me meditation. So what they're saying is, okay, give me 1, 2, 3 steps and then I'll be okay. And the kind of relation they have that, for example, when I eat, then I feel fine immediately. Like if I'm hungry, I eat and I feel full. So it's the same thing with yoga. Like if I do one yoga class, then I'll feel better. But if I sit for 5 minutes for meditation, I'll be okay. So there's this gap in the understanding. Plus, we as human beings have a lot of tendency to give responsibility to others. That now you make me meditate. Now you make me do yoga. Now you make me do everything. Because that is how our learning is conditioned. That we go to school or we go to college, somebody else gives us. So to kind of reflect on that, and it is not so much about what others is giving, but it is about how I'm receiving. So the process of yoga is also about your receptivity. So if we can just become more and more receptive, the more and more this aspect helps us. So that is one thing which I wanted to, especially for the younger generation, that younger generation has a lot yet, yes, I can do it, but behind that I can do it, there is no grounding. So I can do it is good. Like you're taking that responsibility, but for that responsibility to sustain, there has to be enough grounding, enough self-work done. So outside, it might not change much, but the yoga essentially gives you that stability, that intangible base on which you can build anything. So you can do anything in the world. So you don't have to choose between, like people also say that, oh, I've taken a break because now I want to do yoga. So it's like now I'm focusing on self. So there is no demarcation between the world and you. It is like more and more you do yoga from a deeper perspective or you have a deeper understanding, more and more by nature you come closer to the world. So it doesn't take you away from the worldly life or whatever you're doing, whatever your routine is. It just brings you more closer and see the truth of it. Like how earlier I was saying that wherever you are, you see the truth of that situation. So it's very important to see that they are not different. So the more And that is why when you said in the beginning that Shobindra has spoken about all life is yoga. So it's not that, like, there are a lot of people who like routine in their life, who like discipline in their life. So they will do the yoga practices, the chanting and all of those things in the morning. And then they will start their day. And the day will have those ups and downs as usual. But like my request would be that, okay, that routine is very, very good for the discipline of the world. But then when you're going out in the world, take that with you. So that is the first step of that bridge building I was talking about. So if I've had that sense of a calmer mind during my morning practice, take that calmness of the mind in my work also. So it's not that in the morning I've done that everything. Now I'm living a life and then I'll come back, maybe do my night journal or sit quietly for some time and sleep, which is for starters very good. Like, it has its impact. I'm not negating it. But if we are looking for a more inclusive yogic understanding, then I'm building that connection in every action I do. So if every action is connected, that is when my life, all life is becoming yoga. And how is that every action connected? When they're connected to one deeper source. So it's not that every action on the outside needs to be connected. You will say, oh, if I'm studying right now, should I carry my book too while I'm playing? Or when I'm meeting my friend, should I carry my books? Because you are saying every action should be connected. So every action should not be connected on the surface as such. But the intent behind every action is for expansion, to know, to express. So that is why when even in integral yoga, we talk about that inner center, that everything is stemming out of that center. So there's a continuity, everything is connected. And that is that seamlessly you are feeling and experiencing the world. So by nature, by default, you're going deeper and deeper. And that connectivity connects you to the higher. So, I mean, of course, I'm not going into so much of depth, but the message which I wanted to give before we close is that there is no distinguish between my yogic practice in the morning, then my life. So it's carrying that into the world and throughout being conscious of every action and bringing that calmness, bringing that sincerity in everything I do. So yogic attitude is also where you not think of this is a small work, this is a big work, or this is a better work, or there's a superior work or inferior work. Work is work. Like, even if we go in the depth of yoga, we have those different aspects. So that is also something which I wanted to keep in mind, that it is a continuous process and everything is connected within and with each other. So I think that can be my closing, and then you can just say your last words and maybe close. Thank you.
Thank you. So what you essentially sort of brought out many things, but one of the things that struck me was in that the action on the outside may still remain the same. It is from the inside that it changes, the motive and the intention and the meaning that you see in that action, that changes, but the outer actions may remain the same. That is one of the beauties of integral yoga, that you can bring it into whatever work you are doing in daily life. So you don't need separate time for it. In that sense, you may need a break to sort yourself out, but you don't need a permanent break if you want to practice yoga. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Bye.